So now we're ready to start testing. Baby's gone nicely to sleep for us. What we do need to do is get some transducers on her ears. Today I'm going to use insert earphones. These are the IP30 ABR insert earphones. So these are electrically shielded, which helps with, again, reducing all that possible interference that we might have. As we can see, she's sort of lying on her right side. So I think we'll try the left ear first. We've got the electro cables coming away from her. So ideally we want our insert earphones going the opposite direction to reduce any interference. We don't want these touching. So I'm actually going to spin these around behind me and bring them over here. Now I've actually cut these little foam insert tips down so that they will fit more easily inside her ears. You can get the silicone ear tips that come in lots of different sizes. I am a big fan of the foam ones just because I find that they grip against the skin a little bit better, but you do need to trim them down a little bit. So I'm just squeezing that down as flat as possible. We've already looked in her ears earlier, so we're ready to pop this left one in. So different countries and different hospitals, different clinics will have their own local guidance or national guidance in terms of testing strategy and discharge criteria. So I would always urge you to refer to the guidance for your particular area. What I am going to do today is work to my discharge criteria, which is less than or equals to 30 dB EHL at 4 kHz in both ears. Now, what I want to do is not go straight in at 30 dB EHL. I actually am going to start at 10 dB above that discharge criteria so that I can see the growth in the ABR amplitude and also the shift in latency. That's extra confirmation in terms of looking at waveform morphology. So for this baby, for this age, 25 dB NHL is 30 dB EHL. So I'm going to start testing at 35 dB NHL. And we've gone for the left ear because that's the ear that is pointing up, and she seems to be nicely asleep. My EEG is quite calm, despite little wriggles. We'll just give her a couple of seconds to settle back down again. And I think we're good to start testing.
As the test continues to run, more sweeps are recorded which contribute to this overall averaged waveform. And we can already see what looks like a typical ABR waveform appearing. We have the characteristic wave 5 morphology. Now wave 5 generally appears at around 7 to 9 milliseconds at this intensity level, but these latencies will vary depending on age and stimulus type and intensity level. In this case, wave 5 looks like it is emerging at around 8 milliseconds. Here, we can see the characteristic upward deflection of the wave 5, followed by the trough, or the SN10 as some people call it, which typically descends to a point at around 10 milliseconds. A good quality waveform with little interference or noise will generally be relatively flat throughout the rest of the waveform, allowing for the wave 5 and the trough to be recognized. If the overall waveform is noisy, or if there's baseline drift, which can lead to a slope to the overall waveform, this can make it much more challenging to pick out the key peaks and troughs. So it is also useful to make use of neighboring intensity levels, whether these are louder or quieter, to look for the shift in latency and amplitude. Now here we can stop testing the level of 35 NHL, and because we have a clear response, we can move on to testing a quieter intensity.
So the next level is going to be 25 dB NHL. That gives me my discharge criteria of 30 dB EHL if I get a response present there. And I've got my 35 dB NHL, which gives me 40 dB EHL in order to compare the waveforms, look for that growth and that latency shift.
Whilst the waveform for the level of 25 dB NHL starts to average out over time, in order to be as efficient as possible, we can use this testing time to go and start adding waveform markers to the previous level that we recorded. Now, this can become something of a multitasking exercise. While we are adding markers to the 35 dB NHL waveform, it's important to keep an eye on the level that is currently running, as well as monitoring our patient and the EEG in case we might need to pause testing for any reason. Here, I'm going to add the Wave 5 marker to the 35 dB NHL waveform. I'm going to place that just here. But now that I'm happy with the morphology of the 25 dB NHL level, I'm actually going to stop testing because we don't need to add any more sweeps. I'm going to add the Wave 5 marker to this waveform. And the trough marker here. And also add the trough marker to the 35 dB NHL waveform. Adding both the Wave 5 and the trough markers allows the software to calculate the amplitude of the waveform. This value is the difference between the peak and the trough, so it's important to add both markers to each waveform. Then we can move to the Edit tab within the software, where we can read the precise latency of where we have placed the Wave 5 marker and the amplitude value as well. The software will show the values for the waveform that is selected, so you can switch between them to see these different numbers. Here, firstly, we can see the values for the level of 35 dB NHL. The latency of Wave 5 is 7.93 milliseconds, and the amplitude from Wave 5 to trough is 0.406 microfolds. We would expect to see a longer latency and smaller amplitude for a quieter intensity, and a shorter latency and higher amplitude for a louder intensity. Now, we have tested 25 dB NHL, which is a quieter intensity. So if we look at the latency value for that waveform, we can see that it is 8.27 milliseconds, which is longer than the 7.93 for 35. And the amplitude for 25 is 0.326 microvolts, which is a smaller amplitude than the 0.406 that was recorded for 35. So this provides us with the information that confirms the expected latency shift and amplitude change between these two waveforms. And that provides additional confirmation that we have identified Wave 5 correctly in each waveform.
Now, again, some countries, they may prefer you to run a repeated level at your discharge criteria just to have that confirmation. Today, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to move on to test the right ear. So we need to make sure that we have the right insert earphone in. Sorry, little one. Lovely. And we need to choose the right ear. And again, I'm going to do the same level. So I'm going to start at a level of 35 dB. NHL, that will give me 40 EHL. We're still using a 4 kHz narrowband CE chirp, and we're on the right ear now, so let's press start.
In addition to eyeballing the waveform morphology and using the expected latency and amplitude values, as well as the expected latency shift and amplitude change, there is some objective data provided within the Eclipse software that can help inform as to whether there is a response present within the waveform. The FMP value is a statistical calculation as to the likelihood of a response being present and is totally independent of waveform marker placement. However, you must record a minimum of 800 sweeps in order for this calculation to be valid. Typically, in newborns, we are looking for an FMP value of over 7. In this case, we have recorded over 800 sweeps and our FMP value is over 7, so we can stop testing at any point now. We do also have a good morphology, which is further support for the presence of an ABR in this instance. Now that we have an ABR recordable at a level of 35 dB NHL, we can go down to test at a lower intensity of 25 dB NHL. While that level is running, I can take the opportunity to mark up the waveform at 35 dB NHL. If we go back to check on the level of 25 dB NHL that is currently running, we can see a good waveform morphology appearing. Once again, we are expecting a latency shift and amplitude decrease compared with the level above, and we can see that in this case. Now that we are over 800 sweeps, we can read the FMP value, which is also over that critical number of 7, so we can stop testing soon. Once again, in order to establish the exact latencies and amplitudes for these waveforms on the right ear, we need to make sure that wave 5 and the trough markers have been placed correctly. Then, we can go to the Edit tab and select each waveform to read these values from the left-hand side. On this Edit page is also where you can see a range of data at the top, including the final FMP value, the residual noise, and the signal-to-noise ratio, which is calculated based on the waveform amplitude and the residual noise value.
So that is 4 kHz CE chuck tested in both ears, down to my discharge criteria, which is 30 dB EHL in both sides, 25 dB NHL, with that plus 5 correction factor that we need to bear in mind.